Science is a way of thinking. These were the first words I heard when I first started at university. Science is a way of thinking. It's a sentence that one can accept without even much thinking about it. It just sort of seems true. And this is what I did. I just accepted it. Though accepting it didn't really get me anywhere. It doesn't magically make you understand quantum mechanics, nor save you from learning the 22 biogenic amino acids by heart. Actually, it took me quite some time before I realized that this statement is not only true, but indeed one of the most powerful and inspiring insights into the world and our understanding thereof. Science is a way of thinking. And here's how scientists think. This is a carbon atom. Well, it obviously isn't. But it's how we like to imagine a carbon atom. It is a model of a carbon atom. I'd like to tell you the story of how this model came about. Back in the 19th century, two professors were kidnapped from their laboratories and forced to teach a first-year introduction to chemistry lecture. Now, they weren't too happy about this. And frankly, they weren't too impressed by the chemical expertise of their students. You know, they were talking about all these amazing things. Bond angles, and valencies, and angstrom distances. And these students, they just didn't get it. They just didn't understand chemistry. But let's give these poor undergrad students a break here. Their professors were pretty demanding. And honestly, how were they supposed to know? They had never seen an atom. They didn't know how atoms connect to form molecules. You can't look at an atom. That's why these two professors had to come up with this. This is what carbon looks like. Not really. They didn't come up with this model because they actually thought this is how carbon looks like. They certainly didn't do it because they had any data suggesting it did. They did so in order to explain basic chemistry to their students. They came up with this model because it managed to make intuitive what they couldn't. Actually, we can ask some really, really complicated questions using this very simple model. One such question is, what is the structure of six carbon atoms that are connected six times in total? Okay, so let's take six of these, right? Try and connect them six times in total, okay. What do we get? Well, it's a hexagon. And I know this might seem arbitrary, but trust me, this exact structure, this hexagon, comes up all across modern chemistry. In fact, I'm not kidding you when I say that this precise question vexed chemists for more than two centuries. Our model did the same in under 2 minutes. I guess at this point you're wondering, but what exactly is a model? Now, the trouble with the term model is that there's a lot to be said about it, and I don't think any of it is very useful. But you know models. In fact, you engage with them every day. Not all models need to be physical. The way we predict the weather uses models. The way we count infection numbers uses them too. In fact, you all most likely used a model to get here today. You know, let's say you came here by car. You might have guessed the rough time it would take you to drive here, factored in a few minutes for traffic and, let's say, finding a parking spot. And then? Well, then you set off. You made certain assumptions in order to simplify the problem you were tasked to solve. And in the end, you all arrived on time here today. You all modeled your way here today. Well done. One place where models are ubiquitous is science. I think some of the most beautiful models that I know of come from science. One of my favorite ones is this. Back in the 19th century, chemists had a big problem. They just couldn't make sense of this chaotic cluster of elements that they had collected. That is, until a Russian chemist called Dmitri Mendeleev did something very brave. Mendeleev made only two major assumptions, and by it, he invented the modern periodic table. Firstly, Mendeleev said elements can be arranged in regular rows, just like this. He called them periods. Guess where the name comes from. Secondly, he said elements can be arranged in regular columns. And if we do this, it now only feels natural to actually arrange all the elements in a table-shaped way, just like this. And if we look at this table, we find that there are these really strange holes in the middle of the periodic table. Now, there's no reason to believe that are just random, awkward holes in the middle of the periodic table. And indeed, if you have ever seen a modern version of the periodic table, you will have inevitably noticed the conspicuous absence of any such holes. And indeed, Mendeleev turned out to be right. In every single instance, without exception, Mendeleev turned out to be right. These weren't elements that didn't exist. We just hadn't discovered them yet. This is why this model was so enormously useful, not because it revealed anything enormously deep about reality, but because it managed to make such fantastically good predictions that all turned out to be right. This is what science is supposed to be: clear, convincing, nearly self-evident. Mendeleev's model didn't have much to do with reality at all. In fact, in many ways, it turned out to be incorrect. But it managed to make the right predictions, and it managed to make them in a way that was simple to understand. Models are wrong by design. You know, I said science is a way of thinking. I never claimed science is a way of being right all of the time. We're all wrong, but some of our error can at least be useful. In fact, it's not much different from the models you used to get here today. They were most likely off by a bit too, probably deliberately. You might have factored in 10 minutes for traffic. But was it exactly 10 minutes? It might have been 7, but that doesn't matter. What you care about is whether you arrived on time here today. And you did. Just how you might maybe care whether 6 carbon atoms actually form a hexagon. OK, so at this point, I think I have to admit that the story of a little tetrahedron carbon here wasn't quite over yet. Remember how these two professors had to come up with this model in the first place? Because nobody had actually managed to look at carbons up until then. Well, more than a century later, we actually managed to look at a 6-carbon structure. Seems familiar? Well, it should. It's a hexagon. Sometimes science is a way of seeing too. And this is why I love this little tetrahedron carbon so much. Because I was this poor, struggling undergrad student once too. And even me, without any fancy technology or advanced mathematics, could see and feel a carbon atom. This is what science is supposed to be. Science is not about complexity. Science is about simplicity. It weren't the students who didn't understand chemistry. It were the professors who didn't understand science. So let me end on this. Models are the way we see the world. And good models let us see the world clearly. At their best, they connect the unknown to the known, the unseeable to the seen, and the impossible to the solvable. So the next time you feel like you just don't know, make a model. If something seems impossible, make a model. Make it as simple, yet intuitive as you can. And don't worry if you think it's wrong, so long as it gets the job done. The frontiers of our knowledge should not limit, but empower us. And you know, if in doubt, make a model. Thank you.